By providing space for constant evolution, we can all transform how we view ourselves and the world around us.
My name is Elle, and I am an unwell woman. As the author Eleanor Claghorn explains, throughout history, medicine has failed and continues to fail women by treating our bodies as unknowable. She writes, "Our diseases are not elusive to us, but something about them seems to thwart and frustrate medicine at every turn. And the lives of unwell women depend on medicine learning to listen." I'm here to share my experience as an unwell woman. But I'm not just an unwell woman. I'm a neuroscientist whose expertise is mapping the dynamic interplay between hormones and the brain. In the course of my PhD training, I've read hundreds of empirical articles, taken graduate-level classes, and collaborated with experts in neuroscience and endocrinology. I'm in a lab entirely dedicated to advancing women's brain health. I'm literally steeped in a world that pays very careful attention to women's bodies. And yet, it took me 2 years to figure out what was happening with my hormones, in my brain, in my body, to confirm that I have the most common endocrine disorder called polycystic ovary syndrome, or PCOS, which is characterized by ovarian cysts, irregular menstrual cycles, and elevated levels of androgen hormones such as testosterone. And you could say that I'm one of the lucky ones. 2 years could be considered fast for a PCOS diagnosis. By some estimates, a typical diagnostic timeline, so the time from the emergence of symptoms to an accurate diagnosis, can be anywhere from 2 to 5 years. 5 years? People earn a PhD in that time frame. So why is it that it can take up to half a decade to diagnose a disorder that impacts 1 in 10 women? Well, I'm a case study for how the medical system treats women. Let me walk you through how. I remember back in middle school, all of my friends and classmates getting their periods before me. When I finally got mine, it came in fits and starts, which was normal. But then it just completely stopped. To address this, I went to the pediatrician when I was about 15 years old. The doctor prescribed me with birth control to regulate my periods at a time when my brain and body were still developing. She told me I wasn't getting a period because I was a cross-country runner, because of intense exercise. And that was the end of discussion. Like many other naive girls going through puberty with an irregular cycle, I was given birth control as a patch fix, which avoided digging into the actual cause of my cycle abnormalities. When I started grad school, I went off of birth control for the first time, about a decade after starting it. Doctors said my period should come within about a month, 3 months max. I didn't get a period for over 6 months. I knew this wasn't normal, so I asked to have an endocrine panel run. And I still recall receiving a notification from the student health portal and just immediately poring over my results. And there it was, a value that stood out from the rest. My testosterone levels were significantly higher than the upper limit of the reference range. This made me think of something. Was it possible that I had PCOS? I knew that PCOS could only be confirmed with an ultrasound. So I called up student health and I scheduled an appointment with the OBGYN there. Upon meeting with her, she brushed off my concerns about PCOS. She told me I wasn't getting a period because I was just stressed, pointing to my role as a grad student, as if I didn't know that already. There was absolutely no willingness to consider that this might be something else, something with roots tracing all the way back to adolescence. Our menstrual cycle is a vital sign. The rhythmic production of hormones guides all sorts of physiological functions throughout our bodies, including in our brains. And mine was broken. Even if it was a stress-related shift in my cycle, it still should have been addressed. So I pushed back, gently but dogmatically, asking that my symptoms be taken seriously. Reluctantly, she said that if I was that adamant, I could get an ultrasound. And because I didn't show some of the more typical physical characteristics of PCOS, such as excessive body hair growth, loss of scalp hair, or sudden weight gain, she almost had me convinced that all of my problems were just in my head. And that was the problem. Flash forward a couple of months, and I'm lying in a bed with 3 medical professionals towering over me. I can't see the ultrasound screen. I just hear the doctor, the one who didn't believe me, mutter, "Oh yeah, you were right," and begins to roll the ultrasound machine away. She's about to walk out the door. Meanwhile, I'm holding back tears and swallowing a chronic diagnosis that I know from my own research has no known cause, no cure, and is the leading cause of infertility in women. Before the door clicks shut, I manage to squeak out, "So what does this mean?" She basically shrugs and tells me to go back on birth control. Ah, the cure-all. That I might need some help getting pregnant, and that, of course, all of this could still be due to my stress. Right, because I'm a grad student. If that wasn't bad enough, when I later call student health to have my ultrasound records transferred to an endocrinologist, I learned that they weren't saved. I would need to redo an ultrasound to have any specialist review it and to technically confirm my diagnosis. Is this a disease not worth diagnosing? Am I an individual not even worth keeping track of? While waiting to redo the ultrasound and for the official diagnosis, I also learned that I have high insulin and I'm at risk for diabetes, another common symptom of PCOS. I get put on a drug to kickstart my periods and lower my insulin, but I can't stomach it without being nauseous 24/7, and it doesn't help my condition. I cycle through one general endocrinologist and two reproductive endocrinologists who all tell me, "Oh, we'll cross that bridge when you get there," when I bring up my concerns about infertility. Only months later, when I return to student health to redo my ultrasound, do I finally meet with a clinician who believes me, who takes me seriously, and who wants to help me now instead of when it matters, which, according to all the other doctors, is when I want to get pregnant. Out of all the clinicians that I met with, she's the first to educate me about a dietary supplement that has since helped to stabilize my condition. But why did it take so long to get here? Why did my institution of over 20,000 students, 44% of whom are women, have only one practicing OBGYN at the time? And why can it take more than 2 years to diagnose a chronic disorder that impacts 10% of women? I cannot help but wonder how much sooner I would have known about and been able to address my condition had that very first doctor not prescribed birth control as a patch fix, or if women's voices were just taken seriously. Why is it that the medical system is so unprepared to answer questions about women's health? Well, ignorance is baked into the system. For example, a survey of medical schools found that 80% fail to include curricula on menopause, which is something that half of the population experiences. And if it's included at all, women's health is defaulted to as an elective. So basically, we're telling doctors that it's optional not to understand 50% of their patients? Failures such as these in our healthcare system are likely related to the historical dearth of female leadership in biomedical sciences and in healthcare. Homogeneity infuses itself into the very nature of the questions that we ask, or that we fail to see altogether. And while I went through the mental agony of not knowing what was happening with my body and being denied my symptoms, many women experience this in addition to unmanageable physical pain. It's not just PCOS. It's endometriosis, a condition where tissue from inside the uterus grows outside the uterus, causing chronic pelvic pain. It also impacts 1 in 10 women, but it takes more than 7 years on average to diagnose. It's pregnancy. Even after anesthesia was created in the mid-19th century, for years, women were expected to do their so-called duty and suffer through childbirth without it. It's birth control. We see a very similar pattern today, where it's just assumed that women will go through the excruciating pain of IUD insertion without any sort of anesthesia. Since the beginning of time, women's pain and women's bodies have not been taken seriously. And I get it. The irony of my situation is not lost on me. I'm a female PhD student in neuroendocrinology in a lab shining a spotlight on women's bodies. So you could say that I'm slightly more in tune with this topic than the average individual, but I was still a victim of medicine's ignorance. I think that the worst part of my story is that it's not a unique one. It's a broader echo of medicine's failure to listen to women. In response to this, my goal is to find solutions, both empirically and policy-wise, so that other women don't have to go through this. In my role as a neuroscientist, I'm leading a study to examine how PCOS, and endometriosis affect brain structure and function. Understanding the neural impact of these grossly understudied but extremely common disorders is one step towards characterizing what causes them. And in my role as an unwell woman, I hope that this here can be a first step in influencing the next generation of women to be advocates for themselves as they come to understand their changing bodies. By incorporating aspects of the human condition specific to women, such as endocrine disorders, pregnancy, and menopause, into the broader dialogue and into curricula, from elementary school healthcare classes all the way up to medical school requirements, we have the opportunity to transform medicine so that it can finally serve women. Our lives depend on it. Thank you.